हेलो फ्रेंड्स, टुडे इन द फिजियोलॉजी विल बी स्टडीइंग द वी हैड लेफ्ट बिहाइंड देयर वाज अ डिस्कनेक्शन एट दैट टाइम द एड्रेनोमेडुलिन. सो आई वाज टेलिंग दैट एड्रेनोमेडुलिन इज बेसिकली इट वाज अ डिस्कवरी इन या इट वाज डिस्कवर्ड इन अ ट्यूमर सीक्रेटिंग सेल कॉल्ड फियोक्रोमोसाइटोमा. द सेल्स फियोक्रोमोसाइटोमा सेल्स वेर शोन टू प्रोड्यूस दिस एड्रेनोमेडुलिन. And it was said that with this amount of adrenomedulin, it increases the levels of nitric oxide. It increases the level of nitric oxide. And you know, nitric oxide is a vasodilator. That means you will be decreasing the BP. And it was seen that this adrenomedulin is having another effect. It was showing inhibition of aldosterone synthesis. Fine. So what is aldosterone doing? It is increasing your blood pressure. Aldosterone is increasing your blood pressure. Okay. By conserving water, and which will be learning in the renin angiotensin aldosterone system. Okay, there is two things: whether you put pro adrenomedulin, or you put adrenomedulin. Adrenomedulin, both will be causing vasodilation. Pro means it's pro form of this. Okay, it's pro form of this. Fine. I wanted to speak something about ocular reflexes having the effect, your eyes having an effect on the blood pressure. Should I talk something a little bit? If you don't want, then we won't. I want to speak something about a reflex that is called oculocardiac reflex. Okay, oculocardiac reflex. This oculocardiac reflex, it has been seen when you have more pull on your extraocular muscles. You know, your extraocular muscle, this is your eye, this is your eyeball, and this is your, think like it is a camera. You have some muscles like this. You have superior rectus, you have medial rectus if it is the right eye. If it is the right eye, you have medial rectus, you have inferior rectus, you have lateral rectus, isn't it? These are all the moving this camera. So if you want to have adduction of the eye, adduction means you want to bring it in the center. When you move, you are using the medial rectus, isn't it? You pull this region and your eyeball will move here, and the opposite should relax accordingly, not that much relaxation that you will have inversion. Okay. So everything is in control. This I will be teaching you in anatomy of eye. Okay. Anatomy, we will learn what are the muscles of the eye. Here I'm concerned that these extraocular muscles, preferably this medial rectus, please remember, this medial rectus, it has been seen. So what is this process called when you are pulling something? We call it traction. Traction means you are pulling something, isn't it? Traction, pulling something. So traction, when you are using your medial rectus, you are pulling your extraocular muscle, you are pulling your this eyeball. What happens? Or I can say conjunctiva. Okay, any push, any traction on the conjunctiva. Okay, conjunctiva also. Any traction on the conjunctiva or any of your structures present in the orbit, because your eye is present in the orbit, isn't it? Pyramidal structure. So in the pyramid, you have the orbit. You have an orbit in which you have the eye, isn't it? eyeball is present in the orbit, isn't it? Fine, isn't it, guys? So you have a right orbit, you have a left orbit, isn't it? So in that orbit you have these beautiful eyes, these beautiful eyes which you are fond of, isn't it? Which you are fond of. No, some people are fond of eyes, they can die on those, isn't it? That's a song, isn't it? Yeah. So what happens is, it has been seen, when you have any traction on your extraocular muscles, if you're pulling these muscles, if you have traction on these muscles or the conjunctiva, you're pulling something, the conjunctiva or any of the structure present in the orbit, you will be seeing that person, if you have that much pull, the person will have hypotension. Hypotension, guys. Okay. And he will start having a reflex bradycardia. His heart rate will start going down. Starts to go down. Okay. And I can't say down. The word to be used is heart rate becomes slow. Heart rate becomes slow. And patient has arrhythmias. What is arrhythmia? See, your heart moves in a normal rhythm. You have an SA nodal depolarization, then you have an AV nodal depolarization, then you have the Purkinje, here you have in the middle atrial depolarization, then you have the bundle of his depolarization, and you know, Purkinje fibers. Okay, so this is the sequence. So when you have SA nodal depolarization, atrial contraction happens. When you have AV nodal depolarization, as AV atrial relaxation happens, isn't it? So one thing contracts, another thing relaxes. Okay, so this is the normal rhythm following the depolarizations. You have contractions, isn't it? But if I see something happening opposite, that SA node is not generating the impulse, it is somewhere here, somebody else is putting some impulse, a charge firing is happening, I will say it is arrhythmia. So you'll be seeing these arrhythmias. Okay. So how we can see this is, when you are removing the eye, what is the process of removal of eye called? When you have that sympathetic ophthalmitis, or we have that diseases where we have a trauma to the eye, for example, a person pierced the eye of the person, that is called enucleation. The removal of the eye is called enucleation. So when we remove the eye, for example, when I was dissecting, okay, so dissecting, removed the eye, it's not that you put directly something and then remove the eye. You have to be very much, need to have an ophthalmologist with you, an anatomist and a surgeon, so that it can show you which nerve you are cutting, which extraocular muscle you are cutting, and then we study the eye in detail. Okay. And enucleation is the process. So what we do is, when we are removing the eye, we give something sort of a block that is called retrobulbar block. Think that this is an eyeball, laterally I'm taking, and we have this optic nerve at the back. So I am giving a block here. This is called retrobulbar block. So at the retrobulbar block, what I am doing is, I have seen, okay, that this reflex happens. But this is an experimental they have studied. Okay. So it has been seen, once we are doing this, or once we are doing, after the enucleation process, okay, we are able to see, or we have a trauma, ocular trauma. Oh, suddenly someone pierced someone, or something hit him in the eye. He got a damage in the eye. Okay. And it has been seen, once we are doing this, since it is affecting the heart, what we do as a preventive agent, we give atropine to the patient so that his heart rate does not go down. Okay, atropine. Think atropine is anti-vagal. Think like that. Anti-vagal means, so what is vagus doing? Yeah, you will tell me what is vagus doing. Vagal nerve causes dash cardia. वेगस एक्टिवेशन कॉजेज डैश कार्डिया, ब्रैडीकार्डिया. ब्यूटिफुल आंसर. सो डू यू थिंक दैट वेगल रेस्पॉन्स विल स्टार्ट वेन यू हैव दिस ऑक्युलोकार्डियक रिफ्लेक्स? बिकॉज आई एम सो सेइंग हार्ट रेट इज डिक्रीजिंग, हाइपोटेंशन इज हैपनिंग. सो डू यू थिंक दैट आई शुड स्टॉप द वेगस टू वर्क? डू यू थिंक दैट आई शुड ब्लॉक दिस वेगस हेयर M3 रिसेप्टर ब्लॉकर? Should I block this hair on the SA node which is going to send? So should I block here? So I put a blocker. What is the name of the blocker? Dash. What is the name of the blocker? Dash. Dash is the name of the blocker, the drug. Atropine. So this atropine will be acting as an anti. Think like that. It's anti. It's not letting the vagus to work. So what will happen? The patient will not have, isn't it? So this is a, if they will ask you what is atropine, it is an anticholinergic agent. Okay. So who is doing this? Then there should be some afferents. There should be some afferents who should be doing this. And there should be some efferent. Who do you think is the efferent who is causing this reflex? Efferent, at least you know an efferent. At least you know an efferent who is getting the signal, who is you know, then dominating. Yeah, who is that efferent? Not yes sir, you should write the name. The efferent is vagus. Vagus will be the efferent of this reflex because vagus is doing that activity. Very nice. And what are the afferents in this? Afferents who are sending the signal, it are the long ciliary nerves. I was just teaching you, and by the way, I thought I should tell you this reflex, isn't it? So interesting reflex. So long ciliary nerves, short ciliary nerves. So you have the nerves coming from this. Okay. Long ciliary nerves, short ciliary nerves. They are occurring as an behaving as an afferent. Okay? Just making a some schematic, some diagram for you. Okay. It's not perfectly correct, this diagram. Just making life easy. Don't think that you are, I'm not changing anatomy. Just giving you an, right now at this level, since you haven't studied neurology, you haven't studied ophthalmology, you haven't studied anatomy of eye, just giving you an idea so that you can remember. That's what I need. And you can remember it easily, I think. So these are your long and short ciliary nerves. And then you have the vagus coming, which is going to that heart, isn't it? So what nerves are these, anyone? So these are the parts of oculomotor nerve. Oculomotor nerve is a dash cranial nerve. Oculomotor, first year. I'm asking so simple questions because you are first year people. Oculomotor nerve. Number? Oculomotor is third cranial nerve. Okay. Okay, so which ganglion will they end in? They will end in the ciliary ganglion. So they will send the message to the ciliary ganglion, isn't it? So you will have, they will be going to the ciliary ganglion. We have ganglion there, ciliary ganglion. So they will be going to the ciliary ganglion. Fine. And we also have another nerve. That is the ophthalmic division. So if you remember, I don't know whether you have read this. We have fifth cranial nerve, that is trigeminal nerve. Trigeminal nerve has three divisions, V1, V2, V3. Ophthalmic division, maxillary division, mandibular division. So which do you think should go? Which division should take this? Which division? Everyone should answer. It's not that only first year I have to answer. Everyone should answer. Don't be shy in discussing. Very nice. V1. Very nice, Sharia. Very nice. V1. Okay. V1. So which ganglion will they go to? Which ganglion will they go? They will go to dash ganglion. They will go to Gasserian ganglion. They will go to Gasserian ganglion. Fine. So fifth division will go to the ophthalmic division will go to the Gasserian ganglion, and long and short will go to the ciliary ganglion. Okay, is it difficult? No sir, we remember at least this oculocardic reflex. We have long and short ciliary nerves. They are going to the parts of the oculomotor nerve. They go to the I'm revising for you, ciliary ganglion. And we have ophthalmic division of the trigeminal nerve, that is V1 division is taking also. So these two are working as an afferent in the oculocardic reflex, and efferent is the vagus nerve. And how you are preventing the action of vagus nerve dash? How you are preventing the action of vagus nerve? Either you give an afferent block, retrobulbar block, and you give atropine. Very nice. So we are giving atropine. Okay. So see, yesterday I had made you write the nitric oxide, isn't it? There were some things when you were tired and you said, sir, let us go and something. So I was not able to concentrate at that time. I think I want to check whether I have taught you this. Just a second. Just let me see first whether I have written RAS production, aldosterone. Okay, done. This is done. Others I haven't discussed because not relevant here. So you will write only those which are relevant. Means important for you right now. Mm-hmm. See, I want to write something about this nitric oxide. See, nitric oxide, please add something for you. Let me write something about. Have I written prostacycline? Yeah, prostacycline. So add something to prostacycline also. Prostacycline is produced by DASH. At least write this, endothelial cell. And thromboxane A2 is produced by platelets. From what? You have to remember this. Arachidonic acid. What are they using? Arachidonic acid. Okay. Arachidonic acid. This also arachidonic acid. Okay. Okay guys, are we alive? What is the function of this prostacycline? It inhibits platelet aggregation. It does not let the platelet aggregate. Inhibits platelet aggregation. And this thromboxane A2, yes, it's a procoagulant. It promotes platelet aggregation and it causes vasoconstriction. This should be causing vasodilation, isn't it? I'm just connecting. We have read this everything, I think, isn't it? Yeah. Fine. Okay. So endothelins we have written, isn't it? Endothelins we have written. Let me write something about this nitric oxide. Basically, nitric oxide, you can add. Nitric oxide, we said it is a, its old name was EDRF. What is EDRF? Endothelium derived relaxing factor. Relaxing factor. And we said they are produced by nitric oxide synthase from arginine. Arginine, you put nitric oxide synthase on arginine, you will get nitric oxide. Isn't it? Nitric oxide. You should write fast. Okay. Zoom in and out is only possible when you are writing. We are writing just one letters. Very nice. So L arginine. Okay. Now nitric oxide is of three types. Nitric oxide 1. Nitric oxide synthase 2. Sorry, I'm talking about nitric oxide enzyme. I should write it here. I'm sorry. Suddenly there is some distraction. Suddenly when you write something in the group, what happens? I get distracted. Right. So I should write it here. Nitric oxide synthesis of three types. It has three isoforms. Okay, this enzyme has three isoforms. One is called a nitric oxide synthase 1, nitric oxide synthase 2, nitric oxide synthase 3. Just remember the location. This is present in your CNS. This is present in your macrophages. immune cells. NOS3 is present in endothelial cells. Write it like this, I have written. So these are isoform, you remember? Same enzyme, but the, no, like in a team, someone is tall, someone is short, all have the same jersey. All have the same jersey. For example, green jersey. So all have the same jersey, all belong to the same team, but have different functions. One is a nice bowler, one is a nice striker, one is a nice, you know, Golgi. Okay, so think like that. And this nitric oxide is a diffusible agent. It can diffuse. Okay, and you should remember one concept, that is it activates a system that is called CGMP system. What is the meaning of CGMP? CGMP means cyclic 3,5 guanosine monophosphate. Cyclic 3,5 guanosine monophosphate. Okay, so once it goes into the smooth muscle, because who is producing nitric oxide? If I take the blood vessel dash, it is the endothelial cell has that arginine nitric oxide synthesis system. And once you produce it, where it will go? What is below this layer? Muscularis layer, isn't it? You have muscle layer, smooth muscle layer, isn't it? So it will diffuse. Because it can diffuse, it will activate the CGMP system. Remember, whenever you activate CGMP system, you are causing vascular smooth muscle relaxation. Okay guys, are we clear everyone? Vascular smooth muscle relaxation. And there is a beautiful thing. The beautiful thing is that who will inhibit nitric oxide? Who inhibits nitric oxide? Nitric oxide is inhibited by hemoglobin. Nitric oxide is, I cannot say inhibited, but I should say inactivated. It is inactivated by hemoglobin. Hemoglobin will be inactivated. Are we clear? Can anyone tell me how many amino acids are there in the endothelium? Yeah, biochemistry integration, third year. I mean, if I have endothelin 1, endothelin 2, endothelin 3, okay? They have something in similar. They have three similar 21 amino acid polypeptides. So the family which they belong to has three similar 21 amino acid polypeptides. Okay. Are we clear, my dears? Is there any doubt? So this was something I had left last time. Okay. Now there is a maneuver. There is a maneuver. That maneuver is called Valsalva maneuver. Important maneuver. Valsalva maneuver. Okay, see guys. See what happens in the Valsalva maneuver is, just have a listen. Valsalva maneuver is basically a physiological process which you are doing. Okay. See what happens. If I tell you to do, listen, please listen. It's a request. Please listen. It's important. And it's important clinically. Maneuver means you are doing some process. Okay. Valsalva maneuver. Okay. Now, I listen to my words, what I'm going to do. When you are in your going to the washroom, okay, and you want to excrete, okay, you want to excrete, you are putting some strain, you are doing, isn't it? This is the simplest example I can give you. You are going to the washroom and you are straining. What is this strain basically? Strain means you are exhaling against a closed glottis, isn't it? You have closed something at your throat. See, isn't it? You try it. okay, what happens? Are you increasing the intrathoracic pressure or decreasing? You are increasing the intrathoracic pressure, isn't it? Will your systolic BP rise? Yes, your systolic BP will rise. So I will be telling you some phases. So this Valsalva maneuver which you are doing is basically a combination of four phases. Valsalva maneuver has four phases. I will tell you what is the effect of this on the heart. Okay. Has four phases. We have first phase that is called onset of strain. Second phase which comes after that is the continued strain. Third is release. Fourth is recovery. Okay. Valsalva maneuver. Now see what happens. I will start the onset of strain. See what happens. When I am exhaling against this closed glottis, what is this? I am exhaling against closed glottis. So I will say onset of strain is I am exhaling against closed glottis. That is, I am obstructing the airway, isn't it? I am obstructing the airway. Okay. What happens is that you increase the intrathoracic pressure. You are increasing the intrathoracic pressure and you are rising the BP. Which BP? SBP, isn't it? Why this happens? Because when you were increasing the intrathoracic pressure, you were compressing the aorta and pulmonary circulation. What? You were compressing. You were compressing the aorta and pulmonary vessels, pulmonary circulation. This is the phase one. Easy? Okay. Have you written? Guys, are we clear? Okay. Shall I go to the next phase, guys? Okay. Now see, continued strain, what happens in phase two is once you're doing this, you're not finishing actually, it's a phase. After that, what happens is you have a decrease in the venous return. Your venous return will decrease, isn't it? And what will finally fall? Systolic BP. Systolic BP will again fall. Okay. Because your positive intrathoracic pressure is still there. Your positive intrathoracic pressure is still there. I will demonstrate this for you. Don't worry. Please write first. Okay. Okay, once you release this, what happens? Once you release, you are going towards compensation now. Your body is going to compensate. Compensation, isn't it? Compensate means it's trying to correct all these things. Okay, so you will start compensation. You want to go towards normal or abnormal? Normal. This is all abnormal. What happened? So right now everything is happening. Once I released, now body is trying to correct everything. This is compensation, isn't it? So your intrathoracic pressure, okay, now you are going towards the compensation. So what are the compensations? You should know what are the compensations. You have to decrease the systolic blood pressure. This is happening in the release phase because you have pooled. Do you remember the last lecture? You have pooled the blood in the pulmonary vessels. Okay. And you decrease the SBP. After this, again, you will have a shoot of systolic BP because cardiac output will suddenly increase and vasoconstriction will happen. Okay. So you have increased BP and vasoconstriction because of cardiac output. Okay, so this you have to understand. Okay, guys, now let us understand it lucidly how it is happening. Okay, see, when you are coughing also, that is also a Valsalva. Like you have old people, they cough so much, you know, they have those bouts of coughing happening, isn't it? They are doing those violent expiratory efforts, isn't it? Okay. So see what is actually happening is, what is basically happening? I will give you an example because you haven't read the respiratory physiology, but I would like to make it easy for you. Whenever, see, normally when you are inspiring, what happens, you are negatively making your intrapleural pressures. There is a pressure between your pleura that is called intrapleural pressure. I will be teaching you in more detail. Valsalva is again the topic in the respiratory. Again, these topics will come. So don't worry. I will try to make you explain this because you haven't read respiratory. Okay. So some things are that, you know, they are interconnected. So I have to make you explain in some simple way. First, remember that intrapleural pressure is negative. Okay. Intrapleural pressure is negative. This is your lung and this is the pleura. So intrapleural pressure is negative. Okay. And if you inspire more, you are actually making it more negative. Now remember, do you know how you drink some mango shake? Isn't it? Like if you, maybe, I don't know, if you come with me at some place, okay, maybe, I don't know, maybe if I am fortunate much or not, that depends on the fortune. I think it's becoming day by day unfortunate. So what happens? That when you suck something, you are sucking pressure. No, you are sucking, isn't it? You are taking the mango shake in your oral cavity, isn't it? Oral cavity. So this is basically a negative pressure which is generated here, sucking. And if you try to throw it again down, then it will become the positive pressure, isn't it? PPV, positive pressure ventilation. Okay. Same when you are doing more sucking in the chest, you are doing, your chest acts as a suck. It draws all the air inside. Does your mediastinal pressure become more negative? Just talk to me. Don't let me stop. Just talk to me. You have to understand because you have already written. It becomes more negative. Are you actually expanding your thin structures like your thorax? Are you expanding your large veins? Are you giving more space for them to expand in the chest? You have your vessels because they were compressed. But once you are inspiring, you are actually giving more space to them to expand. Will you decrease the pressure in them? Will it cause sucking of the blood in the veins from all your regions? Will it increase the venous return to the heart during the inspiration? Will it act as a suction pump? Can I say I am doing suction? Very nice answer. Is also the diaphragm becoming flat to increase the space? Because if diaphragm is like this, it becomes now flat. So this space is more for the accommodation of air, accommodation of lungs. That means you are giving more space to the chest to, no, you are giving it a wholehearted space. You are giving it a wholehearted space to expand. It can do anything. Because air will only go towards the lungs. It has no place to go. It only knows lungs. Air only knows lungs and lungs only know air. So it has to expand to accommodate that air. Okay. So what you are doing actually is you are descending the diaphragm. And which pressure is increasing? Intra-abdominal pressure or diaphragmatic pressure or the thorax? So this is your diaphragm. This was your thorax where you have lungs. And this is your GIT where you have the thoracic aorta, inferior vena cava. Which pressure is increasing? Intra-abdominal pressure is increasing when you are descending it or thoracic pressure? Which pressure is increasing? This is your chest wall. This is your abdomen. Which pressure is increasing when you are making this flat? That means you are descending in downwards. This pressure will increase. Think like that. Now it's going here. So during inspiration, pressure in the intra-abdomen rises, while as intra-thoracic pressure decreases because it's making more space to the air. So when the diaphragm descends, you are increasing the, not that much, but slight increase is happening in the intra-abdominal pressure. That's why, what a beautiful thing. That's why you get a gradient, abdomen thorax gradient. There is a gradient of pressure, that is abdomen thorax gradient. Very nice. Yes. And negative intrathoracic pressure is there. That is, I am telling, the pressure is decreasing and decreasing and decreasing in the thorax, increasing and increasing in the, that slight increasing in the abdomen. And you finally will be increasing the cardiac output also. And this is best seen in your exercise. But once you are doing some violent expiratory efforts, like you are doing some bouts of cough in the old people, like you are doing Valsalva maneuver, opposite happens. Please listen. Opposite happens. What will happen? Once you do this, what happens is, which pressure will now become positive? Are you making the thorax more positive? When you are doing, you are compressing your chest or not? You are expiring against this closed glottis, isn't it? Where are the students? Other students, they are not writing. They are not writing whether they are understanding or not. I'm worried. Guys, I'm worried about this concept. So what? Okay. So what happens that this thorax, intrathoracic pressure will increase in Valsalva. So in Valsalva, what happens? You are increasing the, you are making it more positive. Intrathoracic pressure is becoming more positive. Okay, basically the intrapleural pressure is becoming positive. I should say intrapleural. Intrapleural pressure is becoming same like way we read there. Intrapleural pressure is positive. Intrapleural pressure becomes positive. Will you increase the venous return or decrease the venous return? When you make something positive in the thorax, what you are doing? You are not letting those to expand. You are not letting those veins to suck because you have increased the pressure. You are not letting the venous return to increase during the inspiration, during the expiration. Okay. You are not letting the suction action. You are not doing a suction action. You are actually giving a positive pressure. Isn't it? So what will happen? What will happen? Your thorax is, you know, compressing against. See, I take a first deep breath. Thorax expand. That's why when we're measuring the chest, do you know that measuring the chest like in the army or something, you know, something like that, you think that the chest is rising like when I'm doing this. Okay, so what I'm doing, I'm increasing the intrapleural pressure, decreasing the venous return. Finally, dash will decrease. Okay. So remember, in short, the story is about the intrapleural pressure becoming positive. Positive then what? There should be a question, positive then what? Remember, see, when they were discovering this system, they kept the atmospheric pressure as zero. Listen, don't tell me 760 mmHg. That's about, we are seeing difference. So when they were measuring, they said atmosphere they took at zero. This is what Harrison is writing. I have read this thing from it. So they took that from to zero, and your chest, they took it as negative, that way negative. So more negative you become, the more negative away you are going from the zero, isn't it? Zero, you go reverse, isn't it? To become minus. So it is because of this positive pressure that you are increasing the intrapleural pressure, that you are becoming greater than the atmospheric pressure, that you are forcing the respiratory muscles against the closed glottis, like you are defecating, you are coughing. Okay, so coughing, defecation, these can be examples. So they give you a clinical vignette in the exam. They say coughing is happening, and this, what is the effect on the Valsalva maneuver? What is the effect on the intrapleural pressure? Okay, can I say also, when I have a chest injury, pleural cavity comes to outside, can I say it is also positive pressure? Yes, all is leaking outside. If I have any trauma in the chest, it is also an example of positive pressure. because atmospheric is come, pressure will come inside. If you rupture this, what will happen? If you rupture the pleural membrane, what will happen? You are actually sucking the atmospheric pressure, atmospheric air. Okay, so remember, this chest trauma is also an example. Okay, fine. So when do you think is the alveolar pressure becoming equal? Do you know alveolar pressure? Alveolar pressure means the pressure of air inside the alveoli. This is your alveoli. The pressure of air inside the alveoli is intraalveolar pressure. And the pressure, and there will be a question that when does this alveolar pressure equate to atmospheric pressure at the end of respiration? So you don't have to go in this. It's a part of respiration. Just forget it. Just have to remember this Valsalva. So one, now I will integrate this with Valsalva. Now what is happening in the Valsalva is you are basically, if you tell me, sir, what is Valsalva? You are actually checking. Let you write this line in your copy so that you get an easy hold of this Valsalva maneuver. Valsalva maneuver is actually testing your baroreceptor reflex. What? Just write it. Whether your baroreceptor reflex is competent, whether your baroreceptor reflex integrity is maintained, whether your baroreceptor reflex is working to its capacity. Are we clear? So just write it for you right here in the, where to write, guys? You write it here. Valsalva maneuver is basically a test of baroreceptor integrity. That's how it can help you understand. You are checking the baroreceptor integrity. Are we writing this line or not? Maybe they put it in the assertion reason. Assertion. Valsalva maneuver is increasing the intrathoracic pressure. B, checking the baroreceptor integrity. So then don't tell me, sir, you did not let us write. Okay, so testing of baroreceptor integrity. Now what is happening is you are forcing something against the closed glottis. You are expiring against the closed glottis. Let me write for you in this arrow manner. Okay, these are the phases. Okay, you have written the phases. Now you have to write some arrow things for you. Okay, some little arrow lines. What you did is you did straining or you did coughing. You did coughing or you did Valsalva. Okay, you did strain, you strained something. So these, what will happen is, what you are doing actually, what is this meaning? This means you are expiring against closed glottis. Okay, you are expiring against closed glottis. What happens? Which pressure increases? Intrathoracic pressure increases. Intrathoracic pressure will increase. What will happen? Less expansion of chest wall, less expansion of the blood vessels to receive the blood, less expansion of blood vessels to receive blood. That means venous return will decrease. That means decrease in the cardiac output. That means decrease in the arterial pressure. Now, since this decrease in pressure is happening, what do you think gets stimulated at the seconds? Dash reflex stimulated. Dash reflex should come at here. Dash reflex should intervene. Finally, just write the answer, guys. You have learned everything. We're applying it. Confidently write baroreceptor reflex. Baroreceptor reflex will intervene. Now this baroreceptor reflex, if it is intact, integrity, competent, maintaining this, it will again start that whole story. What is the story, guys? What is the story? Now you decrease the blood pressure. You are decreasing the stretch on the carotid sinus. Decrease stretch in the carotid sinus will activate the baroreceptors. Baroreceptors will increase the firing. They will increase the firing. Firing of what nerves? 9th and 10th cranial nerve. Okay. 9th and 10th cranial nerve. Now this 9th and 10th cranial nerve will go to nucleus tractus solitarius. What a mechanism. I should thank God a million times. Nucleus tractus solitarius will do two things. It will inhibit the vagus nerve and it will cause activation of VMC, vasomotor center. Inhibition of vagus nerve increases heart rate. Activation of VMC will cause increased sympathetic outflow, guys. What a mechanism, what a mechanism. It is worth 1,000,000 times repeating. What happens? Two things will happen. Increased inotropic action. Positive inotropism is happening and increased vasoconstriction. This will cause increase in the cardiac output. And finally, you will have increase in the BP. So are you actually checking the baroreceptor reflex or not? Now, did I write the nice sentence that it is actually checking your baroreceptor reflex? Clear? Is there any problem? Okay. So you will have an at the end. So if I tell you what is at the end of when your phases are happening, this was the recovery phase, isn't it? So after recovery phase, what should happen? After phase four, what should happen? Increase in the heart rate. This is what you have to see. Now, if you stop the maneuver, now I am telling you, you are stopping the maneuver. Maneuver means you were starting this closed. You have now stopped. You finished the defecation. You finished the defecation. Now you are finishing defecation. You rose up. When you are coming, doing this, there will be now a rebound venous return, a rebound increase in cardiac output, a rebound increase in arterial pressure. Will now this rebound again tell the baroreceptor that it is a high blood pressure? The compensation which we are doing for this purpose, will this again tell the baroreceptor that, oh my God, he has increased the BP. Now this baroreceptor will again put this stick. What will baroreceptor do? Baroreceptor will sense it as if it is increasing the blood pressure. That means it will be stretched by more of the blood. That means carotid sinus will be more stretched. That means increased firing will happen in the 9th and 10th cranial nerve. That means increased stimulation of nucleus tractus solitarius. Nucleus tractus solitarius will tell the vagus nerve to get activated. And on the other side, it will tell the vasomotor center to get inhibited. Increase in the activation of vagus nerve will cause a decrease in the heart rate. And inhibition of the vasomotor center will inhibit the sympathetic outflow. It will do two things. It will decrease the myocardial contractility and will cause vasodilation. And decrease in the heart rate will decrease the cardiac output, which is also happening because of the decreased myocardial contractility. And you will be finally having a decrease in the BP. Are we able to understand the Valsalva maneuver? Who is having doubt? Who is going to make 1 lakh diagrams and then trying to explain this? It's nothing, man. It's nothing. I have taught you baroreceptor mechanism. Apply that baroreceptor in Valsalva maneuver. This is the prof question which comes in the prof's Valsalva maneuver. Should I connect BP? Should I connect the blood pressure measurement with this clinical? Should I connect? Do you know that when we are putting the stethoscope, when we are auscultatory, when we are using the auscultatory method, what is auscultatory method? We are using the blood pressure, we are using the stethoscope for measuring the BP. Auscultatory method of BP measurement, guys. When we are doing this method, we hear some sounds. Please write with a red pen. Those sounds are called Korotkov sounds. Korotkov sounds. I'll be teaching you in the measurement of blood pressure. Don't worry. This is called Korotkov sounds. So when do we hear this Korotkov sounds? When do we hear this Korotkov sounds, by the way? Korotkov sounds are heard during phase 1 and phase 4. Whenever your systolic arterial pressure is changing. Can we understand 1 and 4? Let me take you here. Can we understand 1 and 4 what I am talking about? Onset of strain, recovery. Do you think that it is not, it is right to say? Yes, it is right to say, isn't it? Are we clear? Because we have seen when we are recording, by the way, what are the waves we see in the recording? Anyone? Can anyone tell me the waves? What waves we see when we are recording the blood pressure? I will give you a chocolate. You can try, don't worry. If it becomes wrong also, it's okay. Here we can make mistakes. Mm-hmm. So we have various waves. For example, we have cardiac waves. Let us write the recording measurements, blood pressure waves, BP waves. If we record the BP in a direct recording, we see, okay, direct recording, do you know we are putting something intra-arterial, and then we are measuring the BP, okay? So we see some waves, intra-arterial we are putting, okay guys? So we see what waves? No, we see cardiac waves. What else? Third year people, they don't study, isn't it? They only know what to read from the internet, isn't it? They only go to internet and study there. No, don't read books, only watch videos, isn't it? This is what is the problem has happened in the medical education. We are telling you every time when you are studying, please go to a home and read the books, not listen after listening my lectures, please. It's a request. Go to books. It makes your reading easy. That's what the motto of my videos are. My videos are just to supplement, help you in understanding the concept. But once you finish the topic here, you should go home, read the standard textbooks. I know my videos will be more helpful because I'm explaining it and everything. But please, it's a request that please don't spoil your career. Just go to the home, read books. 5 years are meant for reading books, and that too a standard book, not something that you buy, which we don't know. Should have a nice author and study it. You'll become a good doctor. So cardiac waves are basically, if you increase the systolic pressure or you have a diastolic fall. Systolic rise, remember like this, systolic rise, diastolic fall, you will see cardiac waves. Next wave is TH wave. What is TH wave? Troparin wave. So they don't study books actually. They directly land into third year. They don't read physiology. They directly come to study medicine. Troparin wave is TH wave. What is troparin wave? Changes in your BP with respiration. Changes of BP with respiration. Okay, your respiration will change. These waves will fluctuate. Third type of waves I remember is Mayer wave, I think. Mayer wave. What is Mayer wave? You will see this in hypotension. You will see this in hypotension. Okay. So they also have another name, vasomotor wave. Vasomotor wave. So this happens because of hypotension. So which reflex dash? Baroreceptor reflex here. Remember baroreceptor reflex here. But don't say, sir, strictly baroreceptor. Okay. Chemoreceptor will be also there. So remember, chemoreceptor can also be there. Or even that CNS, you know, CNS, what was the other name of that? CNS ischemic response dash. CNS ischemic response has another name dash. CNS ischemic response reflex is another name is dash. Cushing's reflex, very nice. Cushing's reflex. Okay. So this is what you see. Now, if they ask you someday, they ask you what are the frequency. So let us write the frequency. Frequency of Mayer H wave. Mayer wave, vasomotor wave. The frequency is 0.1 hertz. Okay. So if you see Mayer waves in arterial will be 0.1 hertz. And respiratory frequency will be less. Respiratory frequency will be less. Arterial frequency is high. Arterial pressure frequency is 0.1. Remember, this is less. Fine. Okay. Now, what is happening with the Valsalva maneuver? When you are doing Valsalva maneuver, if patient has an abnormal flow of the blood, that is murmur. I will be teaching you murmur, okay, murmur. So murmur, remember, if there is a patient, clinically I want to write this point, even if you don't understand, don't worry, we'll be learning in pathology, you have to just mention it. And we haven't read the dynamics of some diseases, which we'll be reading physiological, no, association of some diseases, which will be at the end. Basically, in patient of hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. Okay, now see, we have some murmurs, that is systolic murmur and diastolic murmur. I'll be teaching you, just giving you a relation with the Valsalva. Okay, you will understand everything. Just you have to see some things are there, which I have to just mention. You have to remember them till this, now till that class. Okay, so you have two types of murmurs. You have some systolic murmur and you have some diastolic murmur. Okay, now to distinguish, there is a murmur, there is a disease in which we see a murmur, that is hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. This is called HOCM. HOCM is hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. Okay, in patients of HOCM, if you want to differentiate the murmur of HOCM murmur from the other murmurs, you can use this Valsalva. So what happens is that, I will tell you, if you are doing Valsalva, just remember the mitral valve, you know, during the systole, when the systole will happen, if there is any problem with the mitral valve, for example, we have mitral valve prolapse, which I will be teaching you. Okay, just write it here for some time. The murmur of that will occur. Okay, so if there is mitral valve problem, prolapse, mitral valve prolapse, you will be hearing the click. That click will become significant, and murmur also. That will become significant. During which phase? During early diastole. So beginning you will get that. Okay. Fine. So this is your Valsalva maneuver that you have to understand. Okay. Fine. Is there any problem with this? Just write it for you. You'll understand it more in the disease part. Okay. Is there any problem with any person, any problem? Please let me know, please. Okay. So see you all in the next topic. Next topic will be more important. So take care and have a nice day. Bye.